If you've seen either my VHDL or Verilog video, you'll know that Logisim Evolution warned me about having gated clocks in my CPU design. It said that there is a possibility the design won't work right in an FPGA due to the gated clocks. So in this video, I'll remove the gated clocks, and you'll see that there is an unexpected benefit of doing this. The term gated clocks means that the components with a clock line, such as registers, counters, and flip-flops, are clocked by the result of a gate, such as an AND, rather than being clocked by the main clock. Gate delays can then maybe cause the component to be triggered at the wrong time. I now clock all registers and counters by the main clock. They are still triggered by the same lines as before, but now the trigger only takes effect on the specified edge of the main clock. This caused something seemingly strange. The program counter and instruction register now have to be triggered by the falling edge of the clock rather than the rising edge as before. Now all registers and counters are falling edge, which in my opinion makes the design cleaner. Since the clocking was changed, I wondered if the mux on the program counter's input can now be put back in. It was in my original design many years ago, but had to be taken out to make the jump instruction work in Logisim, which then sacrificed the indirect jump instructions. I had to put in a new control line to select the mux line. The indirect jump instruction is now implemented and works. By the way, there are technically still gated clocks. The fetch execute flip-flops aren't triggered by the main clock. However, the D flip-flop is triggered by the start button. This seems unavoidable and shouldn't be a problem since it only happens at the start. The JK flip-flop is triggered by the AND, but I don't think this would be a problem either. It seems to me that it's coordinating all the path enables, so to speak, but the clocking of the various memory components is still performed by the main clock. And here's the new design implemented with the original Logisim. Since some viewers who have seen my other videos might be bored with the same running programs, I've written some new ones. These are various numerical computation programs. First, the ubiquitous Fibonacci sequence. Personally, I don't understand the fascination with it, but it seems to be a standard hello world type of thing, so why not do it? The second one computes all the prime numbers up to 1,000. And the third one computes pi to 800 digits. It took too long, so I cut it off early. These video sections are sped up in order to not take up much time. They take much longer than this to compute in Logisim. And here's a bonus fourth program I added later. It computes factorials from 1 factorial to 365 factorial. I once again cut it short. By the way, I use this version of my CPU and computer because without some of my extra features and with running on original Logisim, it is faster. I wrote a simulator for my CPU. This text-based simulator runs a lot faster than Logisim since it doesn't have to simulate the electronics. You can see all of the Pi computation. Probably in my next video, I'll show the graphical version of my simulator. Here's the program that does the numerical computations. I created settings in Notepad++ for my CPU's assembly language, so the assembler directives, comments, assembly mnemonics, and data have different colors. And Notepad++ can correctly predict what you're trying to type. More readable, mostly C code appears in the comments. Here's the new instruction set. The indirect jump now works. The indirect jump still doesn't work, but because of a different reason, which was mentioned in my first Logisim video. So now there are new indirect versions of the conditional jumps, and a totally new instruction, store a ind. It is the store version of the load a ind instruction. It stores the a value in a memory location pointed to by y. This instruction was needed in the new numerical computation programs. Luckily, the necessary paths were already in the design, so I just needed to turn on the right paths for this new instruction. So the control ROM had to be edited, adding the new instructions. To test the new jump instructions, I created an all-indirect jump version of my other program. This version was shown running correctly earlier in this video. The obvious question now is, does this new design still work in VHDL and Verilog? Well, one problem did come up because when the main clock is used, evolution uses a clock tree. Here's the waveforms of the bits of the clock tree. Dealing with this clock tree all throughout the CPU is a lot harder than dealing with just a normal on-off one-bit clock. I couldn't manage to get it to work with this clock tree. Maybe in an actual FPGA it would work, I don't know. But in the VHDL and Verilog compilers I use, it didn't work. My solution to this problem was to temporarily put in a buffer between the main clock and my CPU. This will cause evolution to not use the clock tree past the buffer when generating the VHDL and Verilog code. The next step is to find the buffer in the generated code and then take it out. Note the 36 and 39 lines. Since line 36 only appears once, the easiest way is to change the 36 to 39, which means the main clock now is connected to line 39. Here's the code differences between the temporary buffer version and the clock tree version. As you can see, the VHDL and Verilog versions still work. I'm glad I took out the gated clocks, and I'm also glad my original design years ago has been proven to be more correct than I thought.